Oh, yes. Oh my goodness, what a card. What a card to draw here.
What's going on, guys? If you want to support our content and pick up this month's amazing Patreon rewards, you can do so at patreon.com/itresolves. If you're interested in custom playmats and sleeves, visit yourplaymat.com and use code ITRESOLVES10YP for 10% off your entire purchase.
What is going on, everybody, and welcome back to another Standard gameplay video. Hope you guys are doing exceptionally well. We have made it to the middle of the week. Congratulations to you guys. We did it, guys. We're here. It's been a heck of a week, as I'm sure you guys have had some interesting times as well, but hopefully everything is going semi-well for everybody, and yeah, we're gonna have some fun today. We got a Sultai Storm the Festival ramp deck here, originally created, I should say, by MTG Malone, and I did have to make just a very slight change because I actually didn't have enough wild cards for this one. He originally had two Jengataxis in the list, and unfortunately I haven't even opened a Jengataxis, which is amazing at this point, but I didn't have one, and so the way I ended up going was including a Desert Doom in the list as a two of instead. Now, this is going to hopefully help us draw some cards. It's also just a difficult threat to deal with. It doesn't lock down the opponent like Jengataxis does. However, that card draw is pretty important. And crucially, it is something we can bring back very quickly with Tamiyo Completed Sage if we need to. And so I feel like there is some viability to having this in the deck, and we'll talk about that as we go through. But this is a ramp deck at heart, so we do have the Creeper, we've got the Florahedron, the Innkeeper, Azusa's Many Journeys going to allow us to play extra lands, the Celestus going to ramp us, as well as the Binding of the Old Gods. But crucially, again, this has some of that mid-range aspect as well. We've got the Meathook Massacre to kind of deal with a bunch of stuff. In that 5-drop slot, we've got quite a bit. Tamiyo, Wrenn and Seven, and of course the Desert Doom. Esika's Chariot, going to be a really key card here because we can copy a lot of different things. Obviously, just the creature tokens that we get. We can copy the artifact, or the treasure token, excuse me, that we get off of the Innkeeper. Importantly, though, we can actually copy the minus X thing that we get off of Tamiyo. The way that Tamiyo works is really unique in terms of a reanimator spell, because this actually brings a token copy of the permanent, not the permanent itself, and therefore you can actually start copying some of the permanents that you create off of the Tamiyo with the Esika's Chariot. That minus seven looks really tempting, but again, keep in mind that is a legendary artifact that you get off of it, so you can't just copy that endlessly. It doesn't really work very well. We do have Storm the Festival just to get a lot of big stuff onto the field very quickly. Another reason why I felt the Desert Doom was pretty good is because that does get hit off of the Storm the Festival, and so I felt that was definitely worth it. All that to say, though, this deck looks really sick. Again, MTG Malone, thank you so much for sharing this list. I did have to make that minor tweak, but I'm actually kind of thinking that might help us. We'll see. I'd really like to play with Jengataxis. I'm very surprised at this point I haven't opened one on Arena. I've opened like two or three in real life and not a single one on Arena. It's ridiculous. But anyway, this is going to be a fun deck, guys. We're going to give it a shot. We do have the Hall of the Storm Giants as well. I forgot to mention that in the land slot. But all that to say, hopefully we can get some wins with this deck and have some fun. And again, MTG Malone will be linked down below, so please go check him out. But let's jump into the games right now. All right, guys, here we are for game number one. And how do we feel about this? It's an interesting one. I think we can try it. We don't have the double black, but we do have Celestus here to help us out. We get another Jwari Disruption. That's interesting. So what we are able to do is play this on the blue side, have a Jwari Disruption available to us, and then the following turn, maybe we'll get another land that we can play out that isn't tapped, and we can go for something else. The question is, do we go ahead and ramp now? I'm going to say no. I'm going to go for the Disruption, I think, here. This may not be the right play. I really don't know, but we're going to try it. This kind of deck generally runs cheap stuff, so I want to run this while I can run it, because truthfully, it's not going to be very viable for a very long time if we don't play it now. I think they're just going to go for it. If we really messed up on that Disruption, that could set us back a good bit here, but we'll see. Okay, taking a hit for three. Wow, and they did just pass. Okay, well, let's go ahead and throw this down. And I guess we'll throw this out now. The trick is now they're probably going to go for anything that they would have gone for last turn. I think the opponent was just playing very smart. Or they just have a handful of removal, which could very easily be the case, but we'll see how this goes. We've got the Celestus, which is helpful because it will get us that Binding of the Old Gods mana that we need to get this Aspirant off the field. But we don't really want them doubling up on threats as best we can, because we will be in a very terrible position if that's the case. Okay. Revealing Eye is the play. This is interesting. Well, this is terrible for us, so they're going to get the Binding of the Old Gods out, if I had to guess. Could be Meathook Massacre, but I kind of doubt it. Yeah, I think we're starting off strong here, guys. No, it's okay. I was really hoping we draw a natural black source at some point, and we just haven't. It's very unfortunate, but it's fine. The menace on this is very annoying. It works great with the Aspirin as well, so they can stack the counters here. And then we have to double block it if we're gonna block it at all. So the opponent's playing very smart here. They're gonna take the Meathook. Interesting. So I think they throw it on the Aspirant just to get the max damage across at this point, and then they start throwing on the Revealing Eye after the fact. Give me an untapped Blackland. Yes. Okay. Thank you so much. It was really important for us. All right. I am going to go ahead and kill the Aspirant here. While this is certainly a long-term scarier threat, that throwing counters around is not something I want to really deal with, because that's a scalable threat. This is just 3 damage every turn, unless they get another Aspirant. So, we'll see how this goes. Yeah, not feeling super strong about this game, I'll be honest. We do get a little bit of ramp with the Binding, which will... We've already got the Woodland Chasm, I guess, don't we? That kind of sucks. All right, Silverquill Silencer is an interesting card. One that I've seen people shy away from mostly, but it is actually a really good card here because they know our hands, so they can name that Celestus, make sure that, you know, if we're going to play it, it's going to be kind of a taxing card. So good on the opponent for thinking about that. We can throw this down. A little surprised they didn't say the Esika's Chariot, because this is a, I think, more important card for us at the moment. We can double block the Revealing Eye or just block the Silverquill Silencer, so I think that this works better. Then again, they could just have like a Meathook Massacre or something that would kill it, so we'll see. Okay. So what's the bait here? I think we just do this. If they can kill it, that's annoying, but I don't really want to risk the Chariot. So if they've got an Infernal Grasp or something like that, I'm not really interested in letting that happen. So, okay. They actually get to put a 1-1 counter here and give it first strike, which is really annoying. Yep. Glad we didn't block with the Chariot, though, because that would have just resulted in a dead Chariot. So I think that was probably the right call still. Yeah, I mean, we just kind of don't have anything. So we could attack in and kill this, I suppose. That also would create a 2-2, which we could block the Silverquill with. I guess we go for it. Just to get the Wanderer off the field here. That's just not a card we can really deal with long term, because they're going to outpower us pretty quickly if we do that. I don't know. We'll see. We leave up a Jwari Disruption here as well. Not that that really taxes them very much, but it is going to potentially slow them down. I don't know what they could have that would really matter here, though. They've got enough damage that at this point they just get to ride it out. A Meathook Massacre would still be really good for us. We could just sweep the board and then be in a much better position. We'd also gain a couple life off of it. Alternatively, we could just get like a Tamiyo and try and power something out that way. I don't know. I think we're pretty screwed here. I mean, we do this and they just pay the 1, but I think we do it just to tax it. I don't know what they would have for one mana, but it's just one of those things where I think that's the right call. Man, we are just getting wrecked. All right, I'm just going to go ahead and concede here, guys. They definitely have it. That was just bad. That was bad all the way through. Let's jump into a game two. All right, guys, here we are for game number two. These hands, man. This has nothing going until turn four. Granted, it's a binding, but I think we have to mulligan. This is honestly a lot better. What do we throw back? I think it's either the Chariot or the Desert Doom. And I think it might just be the Chariot. Both of those cards are really good for us, but we're going to potentially be able to kind of ramp and do what we need to do here. It might have been the Azusa's Many Journeys. I don't know. We'll see. I'm really glad we didn't keep the other hand, though, because we would have been super dead. All right, let's do this. Yeah, you know what? I'm going to go this route. And then we'll play the falls here. So we get to play this next turn. If we get another land off the top, that gives us a next turn Desert Doom, depending on what the land is. And I think that that's pretty good. Instead, we get a Tamiyo, which is not bad by any means. We'll go ahead and play that out. I don't want to throw that out for its Phyrexian mana cost. I think that that's just a bad way to do it. Yeah, okay. This is nice, though, because it can lock down the Monk here or the Luminarch Aspirant, depending on where they start throwing all their counters. So far, obviously, it's been the open hand, but I would really love a Meathook Massacre. That'd be great. So we're going to hit the Innkeeper and get that out of there. That's annoying. Not the end of the world. This is really becoming a bad problem, though. All right. So we're going to get a 3-3 out of this deal no matter what, which is nice. I'm going to play the Desert Doom. This is a card they are not going to be easily dealing with. Because they can't pay that ward cost. They don't even have enough mana as it stands now. And so we can drop this, draw some cards off of this next turn. While we are probably going to take a pretty big hit here, I feel like this is just the best option. We do take five, but this is going to lock down this Monk here. All right, let's do this. Let's go ahead and play that Tamiyo. We can play it like that. That's fine. I'm going to attack in with just this for the moment, and we'll see if they block. Looks like they will not. We get to draw some cards. Wow. Every Tamiyo ever. Okay. We'll just plus up and do this. Yeah. I mean, I think that... Okay. So they're going to get the Likeness of the Seeker out of here, which means they do have just a free attack here. But I do think we had to draw some cards. I don't think we had a bigger or a better option here. So they can kill Tamiyo. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, they could definitely kill Tamiyo if they want. Which is probably the right call, yeah. But that does give us a turn here. Oh, yes. Oh my goodness, what a card. What a card to draw here. Okay, that's amazing. So the question is, do we just... go for the big kill? Do we attack first then draw and see what we get? I think we attack first. Let's steal five. Okay, we got another land. I'm gonna sweep the board. I don't know why I didn't just hit plus five. I'm gonna sweep. We can bring the Desert Doom back with Tamiyo, which I think is really important here, and we get so much life gain back. Oh, man. I hope that that was the right call. I think it was, because, again, we've got multiple Tamiyos at this point, so we can just bring that back, and then we're good to go. All right, let's do this. Let's drop Tamiyo. It's fine. Yeah, so we're going to do this. Oops, five. We'll get the Desert Doom back. This is why I really like... this in the deck versus the Jenga Taxus. Well, I think Jenga Taxus is good. Yeah, maybe we should have attacked with that. Jig Cataxis is obviously great because it locks down so much, but the fact that we can recur this immediately is pretty important in my view. Yep, they're gonna lure it up. That makes sense. They can throw the counter wherever they want. Looks like they're going here. And we have another Desert Doom. That's hilarious. Okay, so let's do this. We're going to pay for the Tamiyo. We'll tap this down. Whoops. So we'll plus this up, tap this down. We'll attack in this way. Get to draw two cards. We drop the Celestus. That's helpful. All right. Cool. I mean, I think we're doing okay now. I mean, that first game was rough. That's all I'm saying. But I feel like this one, we've got something going here. That's good. Not good enough. They need a flyer because we can just kill them next turn. This does have lifelink, but they can't attack with it yet. And they didn't even... Okay, good. Yeah. The important thing, though, is that we can actually just tap that down too. with the Tamiyo, so it really doesn't matter. So we drop lands. And there we go, guys. We got the win. Yes. Oh, that felt really good. All right, we got one more game in us, guys. Let's jump into it. All right, guys, here we are for our final game. Do we keep this hand? If we draw some lands, it's not bad. Dude, screw it. We're going to try it. This is a bad keep. That made it better. We needed lands, so I'll take any and all lands we can get at this point. Looks like we're against a mono red list. Dragons list, maybe? We'll see. Let's go ahead and drop this down. We'll get another forest into play. That's nice. That helps us. But we really need, like, two more lands to be great, you know? All right. That's interesting. Okay. So the question is, do we just... I think we just play this out as a land, honestly. I'm not... The reason being, like, they're gonna be able to kill it. It's a mono red list, right? And they can just kill it with these. So I'm not really interested in letting that happen. This is gonna be a gold span dragon list. There is no doubt. All right. Here's our three drop. That's helpful. I think we go this route, and I'm just gonna do this just to get ourselves a big 5/5 here. That's helpful because, again, if they do have the gold span dragon, we can just block it. They can kill it with these reactors plus the gold span dragon, but I think this is still just the best play. I'm actually just gonna block here. I don't particularly care if this dies. I do care if the tree folk dies, and so this is kind of an easy one for me. That's fine. Again, we kind of expected something here, so, like, this is cool. They do a lot, though. This is scary. All right. On the bright side, hopefully we can draw some lands regardless of what happens. Oh, nope. Okay, they're just gonna kill that anyway. All right. Well, that's annoying, but not the end of the world here. I have another reactor. How many reactors do they have? This is insane. Okay, land is really good. We can do this and get some stuff, but I think the play is honestly just storm the festival. Let's just be kind of easy. Wow, this is the worst. It might just be that, but this is terrible. Yeah, I'm just gonna get the land. It's not very exciting, I know, but I'm gonna attack in. They can double up and start killing these things, and so we do need to get the attack in, I think, here. The good news is we're at 23 life, so we've got quite a bit of room to play with here, as well as just the Meathook Massacre that can come down and kill this stupid Zorn and whatever else they play, I guess. Okay, yeah, sure. These are, like, hilarious. To one target player. So they're going to try and kill us with these. That's hilarious. I mean, that's really good. They have to pay a lot of life to do it. So we can Tamiyo. Alternatively, we can just Zorn. Like, kill the Zorn. Pay 2/1/2. We can't do anything else, though, if we really do that. So I think the play is probably going to be the Desert Doom. No, I think we're going to go this route. We need to tap this down so we can get the attack in, I think. Let's tap that. Let's get the attack in. We have to kill them as quickly as we can here, so I think that this is just the right play. That just means this can't block. They have to pop these off at some point, and they only can deal 4 at a time. So, I mean, we get hit for a lot here, but we still are going to be able to bring stuff back. And they don't really have a lot they're going to do here. So we minus 5, get Wrenn back. Do this. Gain some life. We'll throw the Desert Doom out there, gain some more life. And then we attack in. This is a fascinating deck, by the way. The opponent, whatever this opponent is doing, is really interesting. I just don't know that it's like they got a lot of reactors off of this. I don't know that that's what the expectation would be every turn, or every game, excuse me. And the reality is they haven't. I mean, they're doing a lot of damage, but we're still at 18. And they can only do like one thing per turn. I mean, they get the treasure tokens, kinda, but it's a little slow. I'm not sold on this deck. I think it's a cool deck. Don't get me wrong, but I don't think it's that good. They do get to draw a card, but I think we just win this upcoming turn. Just on the Desert Doom alone. Yep, there we go, guys. We got another win. What an interesting deck that was. Fascinating. All right, let's talk about this. All right, so first and foremost, again, MTG Malone, really do appreciate you sharing this list over on Aether Hub. If you guys don't know who he is, please go check him out. Channel link is obviously down below. But how did this deck go? Well, game one kind of sucked. We were really bad. But games 2 and 3 felt very, very good. I feel like it's so difficult to permanently deal with anything in this deck because of Tamiyo. And I actually really like the inclusion of the Desert Doom over Jenga Taxus. Now, we haven't tested Jenga Taxus, so I'm sure that there's a lot of positive there. However, the ability to bring back the Desert Doom, where you can't do that with Jenga Taxus because of the mana cost, like right off the bat, you can do it later on, but it's a little bit difficult, is pretty awesome. And just being able to draw extra cards in a deck like this is obviously very, very crucial. So overall, I really enjoyed this one. I don't know. I think it's a really good mid-range deck. Like, that's kind of all there is to it. You know what I mean? Mana was obviously an issue and things like that in some instances, but we kind of drew our way out of it for the most part. I don't know. I would suggest it. I would try it out. I would definitely try it out. I think it's a really good deck. MTG Malone, you really put together a banger here. I super enjoyed it. So thank you so much for sharing. Thank you guys so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this one. Please make sure, as always, you like and subscribe and do all the fun stuff. But we'll see you again very soon for some more gameplay videos. Thanks for watching, guys.